We got volume, Tim? No, we do. Go ahead. Good morning, everybody. Just a beautiful day God's given us. Amen. It was just so, I don't know, it was just like you wanted to just jump up and down this morning, how beautiful it was. And it's just such a great day out there. And God's presence is so strong and so mighty. And we're thankful today that we can come and worship him this morning. And before we get into our service, we do want to, again, this week, we have it on our sign, lest we forget. And we just are so thankful for those that fought for our freedoms here in this land. And so I'm just going to invite everybody to stand up, and we're going to sing O Canada along with the choir or the video.
Guys are awesome. God's smiling on you. You know that, right? Every one of you. He's an awesome God. You know, it's funny. I didn't even do this with an intention. And I noticed. I'll admit it. I was up at like 3 o'clock this morning going over some of this music. I couldn't sleep. And it dawned on me, no pun intended, but it dawned on me that, and that's one of the things that's kind of on my heart, is that, especially in these times, there's so many people walking in fear and stuff, and I mean, personally, I don't understand that, but our job, I say to friends of mine, I say, what's our job, though? Our job is to be light in the darkness. Amen. Right? It's all over the old. It's in the New Testament. It's all over the place. Be light. Right? Just as he is the light. Right? Like, it's so important. So, you know, even as we sing, so I notice these songs, they're all about Jesus, the light, and, you know, and about his light and his life and how we're supposed to carry that through, that people see our example and people will see Christ in us. You know, when you shine, and when you're shining, it's because the Holy Spirit's burning in you. And it causes you to shine, and people look at and they see it. You don't see it. You can look at the mirror, you don't see it, but they see it. I should get on with worship. I just wanted to share that. Like, that just came to me just now, so. Shining in the midst of the darkness, shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth you now bring us, shine on me, shine on me, oh shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land. With grace and mercy, send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence. Lord, I come to your awesome presence. From the shadows into your radiance, by the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, burn me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, oh Lord, shine on me. Oh shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Let there be light, Lord. As we gaze in your kindly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me. Oh, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Yes, Lord, thank you, God. In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you
your truth will hold, 'cause your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. You're my lighthouse, Lord. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you, oh, my lighthouse, and I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. Each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you're my lighthouse, Lord. You're my lighthouse. My lighthouse. And you're shining in the darkness. I will follow you, oh, my lighthouse, and I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore. Yes, Lord, you will lead us through the storm. Hey, fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storm. Fire before us, you're the brightest. Yes, you will lead us through the storm. My lighthouse, you are my lighthouse, and you're shining in the darkness, and I will follow you, oh, my lighthouse, yes, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. Yes, Lord. I love that song. It gets me excited. It's exciting. It really is. It's exciting to know, like, man, you get your eyes on Christ. You got your eyes on the Lord. You can't go wrong. It's a win-win. Like, yeah. Just like the lighthouse, he's our way maker. Amen. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, and you're working in this place. Thank you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. Oh, I worship you. Let's sing that again. You are here. You're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. I worship. You're turning lives around. I worship you, so worthy Lord. I worship you. You are here, and you're mending every heart. I worship you. You're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. No, you never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. He's faithful. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you.
there.
Desire.
and seated. Thanks, Dawn. Is that the words right there? Only you? Okay, just... Purify my heart. Refine me with your fire. That's what I want. I want him to purify my heart. I want him to refine me. And I know we don't want to really go through fire, but the end result of fire is purifying us and cleaning us up and just, you know what? That's my desire. That's my heart's desire. My thoughts, that they'd be washed by his word. That our thoughts would be washed by his word. That we would hear from heaven, that we'd hear his voice. That we'd hear what he wants to say to us. Our only desire should be Jesus. Amen? Jesus. Just love that. Love that song. Praise the Lord. Awesome. So this morning we're going to continue our series from Joshua. And just a reminder for those Tuesday night, we still have a couple more weeks left in our series on the Bondage Breaker. It's 14 lessons, but we're going to do 7 now and 7 after the snow disappears probably. And but we're going to just take the next 2 weeks and really been good information and good just icebreaker for a few because some people were not totally familiar with, you know, even the workings of the enemy. So I think it's been very profitable in that way. And so just thanks to Rita for the leadership she's given there and that. So you can view them on Right Media from home as well. But it's good to get together and just a little bit of discussion. So we appreciate that as well. So I don't know about you, but I've been excited about Joshua. And today I'm just going to sit because I just want to be like you. Just sit down and just be at your level and just what God wants to say to us today. And that song that Don sang, the one before last, though, about the miracle worker, promise keeper, that is who he is. You know, that's who he was in Joshua. He was the miracle worker. Not once, not twice, but many times over again, and he was the promise keeper. And so we're going to continue our series there from Joshua. And we as believers, we are all on a journey, each one of us, a little bit different from each other. But I trust our end goal and our end desire is to become more like Jesus, to reach the mark of the high calling that he has placed on each one of us. And so as we noted that the book of Joshua is really a continuation of the journey that Israel had been on so far, as described in the first 5 books of the Bible, the Pentateuch. And so the book of Joshua covers around 20 to 25 years, 25 to 30 years of time, around 1405 BC. And as we've mentioned over and over again, and I know that I've kind of opened every message with the introduction, because I believe the introduction, and from week to week we've seen a progression, but we also need to remember over and over again that in Joshua chapter 1, God fulfilled a promise that he had made 600 years earlier. And so God may have given you a promise that you're hanging on to and you haven't seen the fulfillment of that promise yet. Well, you're nowhere near 600 years waiting for it. You might be 5 years, you might be 10 years or whatever, but God is faithful to his promises. They are yea and amen. And so we look at that. And we know it was due to Moses' disobedience that he was only able to look into the promised land. He was not able to experience the promised land. And so many times as believers, we are only looking in. We're not experiencing what God has for us. And so God called Joshua to be the new commander-in-chief of that army or to be the leader of Israel. And so Joshua was prepared for the promotion because he had been under a great mentor, Moses. Moses was a fantastic leader up until that last point where he murmured and complained against God and was disobedient. But his call, and it just so impressed upon me, and I know it says that God exhorts Joshua to be strong and courageous. And you might say, well, Leonard, that's just, you've been mentioning that every week. Well, you know what? We need it every week. I need it every week. We look at the natural, we can get discouraged so quickly. And so we have to be courageous and be strong and to be bold and to stand on the principles of God's word and his promises to us as his children. He said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. He is there all the time. And so one of the key notes of victory in Joshua's life is because he was a man of obedience. And so you and I, as we learn to walk in obedience, we are going to experience new victories in our lives. And no, we don't always become obedient all at once. Many times we say no to God the first couple times, then we realize, you know what, maybe I should have been obedient in the first place. Obedience is better than sacrifice. You know, and that's Old Testament stuff, okay? We look at law, we look at all the rituals and all that, but yet God called them to obedience. Not to doing the sacrifice, but obedience to God himself in the way they walked. And so God commands Joshua to be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid. Don't be terrified. And that's what I want to say to you this morning. I want to say to those over the internet, do not be terrified. Do not be afraid. God is for you, not against you. He will never, ever leave you. I can't emphasize that more than anything else. He is with you 24/7. That song says, you may not feel it like he's working. You may not feel like his presence is there. But that doesn't mean he's not working. And that doesn't mean his presence isn't there. His presence is with us 24/7. Yes, that sense of his presence gets all bogged up because we get so busy with life and the cares of life, the fears of life. And you know what? Those things interfere from feeling that presence. But you open your mouth and start praising the Lord like you did this morning, you're going to sense his presence in a greater capacity in your life. As you're going through the valleys, as you're going through your struggles, as you're going through discouragement, praise him and he will transform you. That situation may not change, but he's going to transform you and give you the power to go through that situation. Can't emphasize that more than enough. God is with us no matter where we go. And then we had chapter 2 where God instructed the two spies to go and check out the land. And on their return, they come to Joshua and they say, the Lord has surely given the whole land into our hands. All the people are melting in fear because of us. You know, and then we have that beautiful introduction of Rahab and her hiding the spies in return for safety of herself and her family. And she was a woman of faith. You know, in chapter 1, we see Joshua's faith. In chapter 2, we see Rahab's faith. In chapter 3, we see the people's faith. It's faith in God. In chapter 3, we have the miracle of God pushing back the waters as a priest stepped into the water. Those priests stepped in by faith. They stepped in obedience, but they stepped into the water by faith. And as they made each step, the waters went back. Another miracle in their midst. And the nation went across on dry ground and spent the night at Gilgal. And then we had chapters 4 and 5, which we looked at last week, where Joshua was instructed by God to have all the men circumcised so that the covenant relationship could be restored. It was a time of celebration as they were able to partake of the Passover for the first time in over 40 years, the night before they left Egypt. And it says they ate from the land. They ate from the land. And the manna from heaven stopped. And then chapter 5, verse 13, it says Joshua was near Jericho. Now, I'm not sure exactly what he was doing, but he was taking maybe one last look, one last perusal. And it says he was looking up. And maybe he was looking up at those walls around that city. I'm not sure. But while he was looking up, he saw a man standing in front of him with a sword drawn. And Joshua asked the question, are you for us or for our enemies? And the answer was, neither. But as commander of the Lord's army, I have now come. And if we recall Joshua's response last week, that he went face down to the ground in reverence. And we talked a bit about that last week, and I believe that's one of the things we've lost in the body of Christ is that reverence for a holy God. I know when we sing that hymn, Holy, 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 it makes us want to bow down. Just a powerful hymn. Holy, holy, holy. Only we could live with that every day of our lives, 24/7, that idea of that holiness of God. It would transform us and change us. Our houses of turn of worship turn to place of showmanship and all this other stuff. But Joshua had an encounter with the commander-in-chief of the Lord's army. Hallelujah. And then we come to chapter 6, the Battle of Jericho. And I was thinking that, I'm not sure if you can remember when you were a kid in Sunday school or in VBS, and we used to sing that little song, Joshaphat the Battle of Jericho, Joshaphat the Battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down. Or was that my show, my age, or do you remember that song? You may talk about Gideon, and you may talk about men of Saul, but there's none like good old Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. Hallelujah. And then it says, up to the walls of Jericho, with swords drawn in his hand, go blow them horns, cried Joshua. The battle is in my hands. And so the story of the Battle of Jericho and the walls falling down is no fairy tale. And so let's just pray at this point. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you've brought us to the walls of Jericho and we're about to march around them. Lord, I pray you'll speak into our hearts and our lives this morning. Lord, there may be walls in our lives, in our minds, in our hearts this morning, and we ask, Lord, that you will reveal them to us. That, Father, we will see those walls come crumbling down, that we can walk in victory and not in defeat, not imprisoned, but set free. So, Father, I ask that you'll give me the words to speak this morning, not my words, but your words, Lord. May it come through with a mighty anointing and authority, I pray. Lord, I pray for each one over the internet as well, that we can receive what you'd have today for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Even skeptics of the Bible admit that the destruction of ancient fortress city of Jericho was no myth. The first scientific excavations of Jericho were conducted by two German archaeologists in 1907. And back in 1990, March 5th, the Time magazine, who is not really, Christian, so forth, whatever, but ran an article in their science column called Science, Score One Up for the Bible. Fresh clues support the story of Joshua at the walls of Jericho. And so in this report, it said Jericho was the second most excavated city in the land, only second to Jerusalem. It was about 9, maybe 8, 9, 10 acres in width or length or whatever you want to call it, in distance, and it was more like a mound. And it had been examined by the Germans, the British, the Americans, Palestinians, and Israel. And, you know, they don't agree on everything, but they do agree on a few things. That the city was destroyed suddenly. And there's different theories on maybe why. Some of them want to lean towards an earthquake. But you know what? Even some of that wall was still standing when they did these excavations. And that was that section of land that Rahab had lived on. That part of the hill or that part of the wall was still there. God was faithful to his word. The city was burnt after it was destroyed. They all came to that same conclusion. The city was burnt after it. Also, the city was destroyed in late spring after the harvest. And the city was well supplied with food and water. And so as we look at the story of Joshua and the siege of Jericho, we can see a clear parallel between Joshua's times and our times. Like the Canaanite world, our world is full of immorality and idolatry. Atheism, paganism, false religions are on the march all around about us, and they were back then. And so we truly do live in Jericho times, living in a morally and spiritual corrosive days. It would be easy for us to say, let's pack it in and let's give up. They want to close our churches up. But let us turn to our Bible. In chapter 6, verse 1, it says, now Jericho was tightly shut up because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. Well, what do we know about Jericho? Well, there's a few things. That it was one of the oldest cities. That it was a fortress city. And so the excavations conclude that there was two walls, an outer wall, which was possibly 6 feet wide, and then an inner wall that was actually 12 feet wide, and that they were 30 feet in height. It was quite magnitude. And some even say there may have been a ditch around about the outside of the city. I'm just kind of think that one through, but that's what some of them say. But verse 1 says that the city was locked up tight because of the Israelites. You know, the people of Jericho felt safe and secure behind those walls. In their mind, in their natural mind, there was no way that Israel was going to come in there and defeat them. They were safe and secure. Can you imagine being behind these two big walls? Other than maybe living on that outside wall, but imagine that. 30 feet tall. How in the inhuman mind could we see this happening? You know, they were safe in there. They believed their gods were going to hold them up. And then on the other hand, we have Israel on the outside looking in, seeing these walls, and they're thinking in their natural mind, how are we going to knock this down? God told us we're going to get it, and yet how are we going to do it? So in the natural, they were impossibilities. But we know in God, in the supernatural, all things are possible. And so we know that. In verse 2, God tells Joshua, I have given Jericho into your hands, along with the king and fighting men. The victory had already been won. All Joshua and the people had to do was be obedient. And so in verses 3 to 10, God downloads the strategy for Joshua and the people to follow. Francis Schaeffer, who was a writer, he wrote, Joshua did not take the city merely by a clever human military tactic. Francis says, the strategy was the Lord's. You know, God always has sound, logical reasons for his actions and commands, even if we are unable to grasp his logic at the time. God tells Joshua to have the army march around the city, and not to impress the Canaanites, I don't believe, but to teach the Israelites. God made them march around those city walls to convince them that there was no other hope in conquering Jericho by human strategy, but it was only by divine. Maybe you've been going through a time of trials in your life that seemed completely hopeless. Maybe you feel like you're marching around the walls of Jericho again and again and again. 5 years ago, 10 years ago, now you're still wrestling around that same wall, accomplishing nothing, and wondering if there's any point to go on. Maybe God wants to teach you and me something this morning. That nothing is possible. All things are possible with God. All things are possible with Him. God is our only hope in time of trouble. He is our source. He is our goal. No situation is too difficult or too hard for our God. Amen? Nothing's too difficult for God. No problem is too much for Him to solve. God is waiting for us as His children to call out to Him and say, Lord, I trust You. I need You, Lord, to tumble this wall for me in my life. And so God's plan for the conquest of Jericho was seemingly foolish, but it worked. God's wisdom is far above ours. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9, I love those words, but he says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. 1 Corinthians 1, 26 to 29. He says, in verse 27, he says, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. Verse 28, God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things, and the things that are not to nullify things that are, so that no one may boast before Him. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and these words, we know them well, I believe, but he says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him, and He will make your path straight. Brothers and sisters, there are a lot of things I don't understand as a believer. Yeah, but you're the pastor, you need to understand it all. I don't understand it all. But I leave those things I don't understand in God's hands. Those things that I don't understand, I've determined I will not allow them to become a stumbling block in my own personal life. I will not allow them to discourage me. I will not allow them to take me down and to lose my focus. My strength and my hope is in the Lord. There was a song wrote in 1975 called God Said It and I Believe It. It was sung by the Heritage Singers. I don't know if you remember that song. His faith is the essence of things unseen, the substance of things hoped for. God's word has said it, and I believe it. For the miracle has happened to me. God said it, and I believe it, and that settles it for me. God said it, and I believe it, and that settles it for me. Though some may doubt that his word is true, I've chosen to believe it. Now, how about you? It said, God said it, and I believe it, and that settles it for me. God delights in using the weakness and seemingly foolish things of this world to defeat the enemies so that God may be glorified. 2 Chronicles 16, verse 9. It says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on the behalf of them whose hearts are perfect towards him. And my prayer this morning is that God, that he would show himself strong on behalf of all believers in our land, and that we will see a shift in our culture and we'll see a shift in our churches back to God, that he will show us his power and his glory, and that our lives would manifest his power and his glory and his light in this world. We are called to be light in the darkness. Show yourself strong, Lord, on behalf of Canada. And I was thinking about God, oh God, show yourself strong on behalf of Don's wife, Deborah, who needs a touch in her body. Show yourself strong on behalf of Margaret, who needs a touch in her legs. Lord, show yourself strong on behalf of Brother Dave, who needs a touch in his body. Lord, show yourself strong on behalf of those that are wrestling with cancer and depression and fear. Lord, show yourself strong on behalf of Brother Don. Show yourself strong on behalf of Rick. Lord, show yourself strong on behalf of those that you love and that love you and are struggling with drugs and alcohol and pornography and suicidal thoughts. Oh God, you are a miracle worker. Oh God, you are a promise keeper. You are the light in the darkness. That is who you said you are. We stand this morning on this. I stand on this, and I trust we stand on this morning. That God will move in our midst, that God will move in our lives. And as we seek his face, we will see his handwork, we will see his power, we'll see his glory. May the church arise. May the church of Jesus Christ arise in the name of Jesus. Brothers and sisters, my heart's desire is that God breaks down the walls in our lives like he did the walls around Jericho. Joshua commanded the army to get ready and start marching. He tells the seven priests to grab their trumpets of horns. And Don, he brought his shofar this morning. So that's awesome. And so if we look at that, I just want to make sure my pages didn't get switched here on me. And so he tells the army, I'm going to just make sure we do this right, but he tells the army to get ready. He tells them, get ready. They go in the forefront. He tells them what's going to happen. You're going to have your seven priests with their trumpets. And then you're going to have the four priests that are carrying the Ark of the Covenant. And then the rest of the soldiers are going to be in behind. And then the trumpet players are to blow their horn all the way around the city, all the way around that city. Well, they said it takes about 20 minutes to go around that city, 20, 25 minutes around. And so the thing is, the armies were instructed not to give a war cry. They were not to raise their voices. They were not to say a word until Joshua told them to. And so they went around, marching around that city. And they led that army around. And the seven priests blowing their horn. Don, blow us a horn there for us. And so they went around day one. They went back to camp. So day two, they went back again. The army, the seven trumpet players, the Ark of the Covenant, and the army following behind, and the trumpet blasts again. And day three, we have the same thing again. Go ahead, Don. Day three. So then they went back to the camp for the night, and then we have day four. And then day five, they go around again, the camp. And then we have day six. One more time, they go around. Then we got day seven that comes. And then there are some special instructions given. First note, the seventh time was on the Sabbath day. And on the seventh day, Joshua had these instructions. He tells them they're going to go around the city not once, twice, but they're going to go around it seven times. Wow, so if you figure that seven times, 20, maybe 30 minutes, it's going to take. And when you hear the loud sound of the long blast on the trumpet, found in verse 5, then all the people are to give a shout. Then the walls will collapse and every man will be able to go straight into the city. So we're going to go number seven, and I'm not sure if Don figured out how he's going to do the long blast, but we need to note there's going to be a long blast. So they went around it. So they get up early that morning. They had a good night's sleep. They had their Wheaties, whatever, and they go around that city once, and he's blowing the horn. They went twice, three times, four times, five times, six times. And then on the seventh, yeah, we're all going to shout, guys, right? We're going to shout. Amen! Victory! And they ran into the city, it says. They were able to run into the city and go into the city. And so the walls collapsed. And collapse inwardly. And we notice in verse 17, the city and all that is in it are to be devoted to the Lord. Everything was to be devoted to the Lord. Only Rahab and the prostitute and all those who are within her family shall be saved, because she had hid the spies. Verse 18 says, but keep away from the devoted things, so that you will not bring about your own destruction by taking any of them. Otherwise, you will make the camp of Israel liable to destruction and bring trouble on it. And then verse 19, and all the silver and gold and the articles of bronze and iron are sacred to the Lord and must go into the treasury of the Lord. And so we actually did this a little bit, but okay, and then on the seventh day we just went through it all. But that's awesome. And so they went straightway in. And verse 21 says, they devoted the city to the Lord and destroyed with the sword every living thing, every man, every woman, every young, old, cattle, silver, sheep, and donkeys. In verse 22 and 23, the spies go in and rescue Rahab, her father, mother, brothers, and all who belong to her, and put them in a place outside this camp of Israel. And if you go into verse 24, then they burned the whole city, but put the silver and gold and articles and bronze into this treasury of the Lord. In verse 25, speaking about Rahab, it says she lives among the Israelites to this day. So she was outside the camp. Well, I guess they were doing their thing, and then when they were done, she came to be with them. In verse 26, at that time, Joshua pronounced this solemn oath. Cursed before the Lord is the man who undertakes to rebuild the city of Jericho. And it had been rebuilt a few times. At the cost of firstborn son will he lay its foundation. At the cost of his youngest will he set up its gates. So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame spread throughout the land. And so it is a very victorious story. But there was a couple of side notes I wanted to note in there, was the importance of the number seven. And we know that in biblical numerology, the number seven represents completeness or perfection. The Hebrew word translated seven comes from a root word that means to be full, to be satisfied. And if we look in our scripture today, it says seven priests and seven trumpets. In verse 15, on the seventh day, marched around the city seven times. The Sabbath was celebrated on the seventh day of the week. We know the 7 weeks from Passover is Pentecost. 7 year is the sabbatical year. After 49, 7 times 7 comes the year of Jubilee, which is very prominent in Israel's history. 3 of the feasts fell on the 7th month, Feast of Trumpets, which we got a lot of trumpet there, Day of Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles. When God created the heavens and the earth, what did he do on the 7th day? He rested. The promise that God gave to Joshua, to Abraham in Genesis 12, verses 1 to 3, there were 7 parts to that promise. We look at the New Testament, we look at the book of Revelation, we see the 7 churches, 7 angels, 7 seals, 7 trumpets, 7 stars, 7. Now, 7 isn't a lucky number, but 7 is the number of perfection. It's God's number. And the other thing to note there as well was the Israel, they used 2 kinds of trumpets as well. They used a trumpet that was made of silver, or they made one like Don has there, shofar, which is important too as well. And so we come to just amazing how that, we vision, the story as a kid in Sunday school, we had a lot of fun with that song. But there was this little thing I did read, and it was the 7 lessons from the Battle of Jericho by Dudley Rutherford, and it's from the book Walls Fall Down. And his number one point was, focus on the power of the Lord, not the size of your problem. So if you've got a wall in your life, number one thing is to focus on the Lord and not on the wall, not on the problem. Trust in God, even though it doesn't always make sense. It may not make sense right now when he's speaking into you, but it will. See the supernatural. I think we need to understand that God is a supernatural God, and he works supernatural ways in all situations. Number 4, surround yourself with other believers committed to the same goal. Have people around you that are going to walk that walk with you and walk you through that wall with you and help that wall come down. Number 5 was keep putting one foot in front of the other. And that's very important, that we keep one foot in front of the other. We keep going forward. So many times we're looking back. We're just kind of looking back and struggling. Number 6 is follow God's instructions every step of the way. Again, walk in obedience. Can't emphasize that. I'm still learning that whole thing, walking in obedience. Again, we talk about walking in obedience, not necessarily talking about do's and don'ts. It's talking about just the promptings of the Holy Spirit, what he's speaking into your spirit, what he's speaking into your life is being obedient. Bless this one. Do this. Walk this way. It's being obedient. Give a word to this one. Being obedient that way. And 7, get ready for a season of joy. There is a time of celebration. And church, the problem is that we fail to realize that we've already won the war through Jesus Christ. The battle's been won through Jesus Christ. We forget Jesus' words that he says the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Who's the church? We are all part of the church. The gates of hell will not prevail against us. And sometimes we pull back in fear because we lack the faith to believe our Lord's promise of victory. The great English Bible teacher, Captain Wallace, put it this way: the triumphant Christian does not fight for victory. He celebrates a victory already won. The battle has been won. The battle belongs to the Lord. Many times as Christians, when somebody hurts us or offends us, we have a tendency to put a wall up. We put that wall up because we think it's going to protect us. But you know what really what it does? It imprisons us instead of protect us. The wall of offense needs to come down. One of the biggest problems in the church today in general is offense. It needs to come down. The wall of contention needs to come down. The wall of pride needs to come down. The wall of self-justification needs to come down and justifying the sins that we might commit. Oh, well, I'm forgiven anyway, so I can do what I want. The walls of self-righteousness need to come down. The walls of fear need to come down. The walls of frustration need to come down. The walls of confusion need to come down. There's so many people confused. Those walls need to come down in Jesus' name. Jesus has come to set the captives free. Amen? And God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, wants those walls to come down. The commander of the Lord's army is on your side, has already won the battle. I love that song. And he's working behind the scenes, working everything out for your good. Not everything's good, but he's working out everything for your good. We see the little puzzle. We only see what's in front of us, but God sees the big puzzle. He sees Canada, and he sees the big puzzle. He sees your life, and he sees the big puzzle. We only see that little thing in front of us, but he already sees the victories that you're going to, as you walk closer to him, walk in obedience. I don't know what the future holds, but that thing, that saying, but we know who holds the future. He holds the future in the palm of his hand. Don't let your heart be troubled. Trust in God. Amen. Let's close prayer. Father, we just come before you this morning. Lord, I pray you'll take these words. May they inspire somebody, Lord, today, to face that wall that they might have surrounded about themselves. Lord, that they'll trust you for that wall to come down. Oh, Lord, you are so good. You came to set the captives free. You came to break down prison walls. You came to help us, oh God. We thank you for that. Lord, we stand in need of your Holy Spirit. Do your work in our hearts, I pray, today, Lord, in the days that lie ahead. Lord, we just thank you this morning for all you could do and all that you're doing in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Don's going to play Surrounded for us. And I wish he could play Surrounded and do the show for at the same time, but that's kind of impossible. But
yes, I can.
That was wonderful. Okay.
Can you pass me the chauffeur?
Sure. Put your earmuffs in if you need them, okay? Well, just...
No, it's just...
Just in case. You might want to... I love the sound of that thing.
You know, I don't want to lose what the Holy Spirit's given me here. With the blowing of the chauffeur... There's a couple of churches I go to sometimes, like up at the cottage and stuff, and they just, actually the pastor gets mad at me if I don't bring the shofar in, and they just love it. But I think it's because I don't know what it is. It's the Spirit moves in different ways, right? In different places, he's doing different things. But when we blow the shofar, no matter why you're blowing it, if you think about it, we're making a declaration, regardless, no matter what you do.
Amen.
You're
yes.
making a declaration that Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
And when you do that, it's reminding the enemy that his time is short, and that you
yes.
know it, and he knows it, and just be reminded of that, right? And it just alerts him, reminds him. He does whatever he wants. He's smug, so. But I had it. You want to lose this. This song, it talks about this is how we fight our battles, right? We fight our battles because we constantly, no matter what we do in our walk, we're declaring Jesus as Lord.
Amen.
Whether you're walking along the street and all of a sudden you hear a bird sing and you just see him, he's singing to the Lord. Right? This is how we fight our battles.
Amen. Yes.
It's Lord. All spiritual. It's spirit realm, right? And in the natural, we are encouraging ourselves and we're lifting ourselves up, but also spiritually. So I just wanted to throw that out there as kind of reinforcement, remind us that, you know, everything we do, when we want to walk in the light of Christ, we're declaring that he is Lord.
Amen.
Man, that's so powerful.
Amen, yes.
I love it. So I just wanted to give this just a one little toot, just to let it sink into your spirit. And as I do that, just envision the supernatural realm, how this, you know, this is opening up, as far as I'm concerned, this opens up a portal or a doorway into the heavenlies. And whatever happens, happens, right? Like, I don't understand the spiritual realm at all, so who am I? But, you know, I've gone to places, and I mean, I can blow my trumpet, and people won't. It's not a big deal, but you blow this and it rises the hair on the back of your head. Because to me, it's stirring up the spirit within you. It just goes, what? Yeah, yes. You know, Jesus Lord, right? I could just see General Joshua out there when they let this thing rip. He was just, can you imagine? Wow. Those are huge walls, man. They were like way taller than that. That's only like maybe 20 feet, not even that. And they were like, one was, like, how thick was it? Like 12 feet, and the other one was what?
Six.
Like, you can't push those over, right? So anyways, just let me blow this, and just as a, get that in your spirit.
Amen. Ah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. There's a table and you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. Let's sing that again. There's a table that you've prepared for me in the presence. Your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. And I believe you've overcome. And I will lift my song of praise for you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how we worship you, Lord. In the valley, I know that you're with me. And surely your goodness and your mercy follow me. So my weapons are praise and thanksgiving. This is how I fight my battles. Look like like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles, Lord. This is how I fight my battles. This is how we praise you. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles, Lord. This is how we fight our battles. Oh, this is how. Oh, and it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. We praise you, Lord. This is how we fight our battles. Oh, this is how we declare you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I believe. My song of praise for all you've done. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles.
Until next Sunday. So thank you. God bless you.